question, Russ, and thank you all for inviting me here to give this talk today. So what I'm talking about today is the, as the title says, the order of demonstrative, numeral, adjective, noun, because languages differ in terms of the order in which those elements appear. In English, the order is as stated in 1, the demonstrative comes first, the numeral comes second, the adjective comes third, and the noun comes last. Those three black horses. So what I'm going to do today is to report on the relative frequency of the different orders in a sample of 528 languages. Actually, if you add up the figures, it's now 529. And I will be comparing a generative approach by Cinque, 2005, to an explanation for the relative frequency to my own account in terms of a set of five surface principles. Both approaches use a set of principles to account for the relative frequency of the different types. A crucial difference is that Cinque's account is formulated in terms of syntactic categories, while mine is in terms of semantic categories independent of the syntactic realization of these semantic categories. And I'll provide evidence that, in fact, that's the way you have to do it. So the starting point is one of the universals from Greenberg, 1963, stated in 3 on the handout: when any or all of the items demonstrative, numeral, and descriptive adjective precede the noun, they are always in that order. If they follow, the order is either the same or its opposite. So the 24 logically possible orders are listed in 4, grouped into 4 groups. 4A lists the 6 possibilities where all 3 modifiers precede the noun. B is the 6 possibilities where all 3 modifiers follow the noun. 4C is ones where 1 or 2 precede and 1 follows. And D is ones where 1 precedes and 2 follows. The numbers, which I'll say more about later, are the number of languages in my sample of that particular type. The asterisks here are the types that Greenberg's universal 20 predict should not exist. You'll see, just in terms of the numbers, that the English order is not actually the most frequent order. There are 104 languages in the sample of that, but there are 50% more, 163 languages, with the first order in 4B, which is the complete mirror image of the English word order. And in 5, I've given an example of a language of that employs this order. This is the language of Papua New Guinea I've been working on the most, and have a grammar that's about 95% written. So in 5, things small to these rather than these two little things. If you look at the data in 4, you'll see that in 4B in particular, Greenberg only allowed 2 possible orders if these all follow the noun, but in fact all 6 possibilities have been found. And this is something that's been known for a while, since Hawkins 1983, as well as Cinque 2005. In fact, apart from the first one in 4B, the second one was the only other one that Greenberg allowed, but it's actually one of the least frequent of those types. One of the ones that's excluded of actually 34 languages in my sample. So on the next page, I've given some examples of some of these other orders of modifiers following the noun. The example in the 7 from Akka, it's better Burman language, is the type where there are 34 types where it's noun, adjective, demonstrative, numeral, the mirror image of English, except that the demonstrative comes closer to the noun than the numeral. So in 7, person, good, those, two. Another of these orders that Greenberg's formulation excluded is given in 8, where the noun is followed by demonstrative, adjective, noun. And I've given an example from Noun, a Niger Congo language. The rarest of the types where all 3 modifiers follow the noun, we only have 1 language. That 1 language is listed in 9. Haya, a Bantu language, where it's noun, numeral, demonstrative, adjective, so house, to, these, good. Now, as I say, it's been known since Hawkins 1983 that there are all these types where modifiers follow the noun that were excluded by Greenberg that actually are tested. However, what's new in my sample is there are actually two types where all three precede the noun, but not in the order that we have in English. This is something that was assumed until recently, including Cinque 2005, not to be possible. So there are three languages where the order is as in English, except the adjective precedes the numeral, where it's these black three horses, for example. So one of these languages is Difehi, which is an Indic language, also known as Maldivian, spoken on the Maldive Islands. So in 10, this good three book, for these three good books. And the other two languages are two Nak languages in the Nak-Dagestani family, English and Chechen. And example 11 illustrates this for English, these big three apples. The second type that's previously unattested, where all three precede the noun but not in the right order, is illustrated by Wuvudu number 12, where it's the numeral comes first before the demonstrative, and then the adjective and the noun. The grammar doesn't actually give us an example explicitly illustrating that the numeral precedes the demonstrative. The example in 12 is one where the numeral is preceding the definite article, but it's implicit in the description that, in fact, the demonstrative and definite article occur in the same position. And the second language of this type is listed in 13. In fact, I've only discovered this earlier this week, Sierra Papaluca. The same order, the example here illustrates the numeral preceding the demonstrative. It wasn't clear from the grammatical description whether the adjective preceded or followed the demonstrative, but I found in an email on Wednesday that from the author that, in fact, the order is numeral, demonstrative, adjective, noun. So we have these two types, which are not the English order, but where all three precede the noun. Okay, so the next section I'll briefly describe Cinque's approach, and since I assume that most people here will have relatively little interest in the details of his account, I'll do this extremely quickly. So a summary in 15. Cinque assumes that all languages are underlyingly demonstrative, numeral, adjective, noun, and that all the other word orders are derived via movement. Other assumptions that all movement is leftward and upward, only constituents containing the noun move, and crucially, different combinations of movement are less marked or more marked. So I won't go through the details of this. In 16, you'll see that some of these types are labeled as unmarked, some are labeled as marked, and some are labeled as very marked. So just to give a few little examples, 17b, if you start with demonstrative numeral, adjective, noun, order, if you move the noun before the adjective, you get the order demonstrative, numeral, noun, adjective. Interestingly, by the way, Cinque assumes that the basic word order, underlying order, is demonstrative, numeral, adjective, noun, despite the fact that his own native language is the one illustrated in 17b, showing the sociological power of English in linguistics. Okay, C just shows where the noun moves twice and ends up after demonstrative. It's also possible for constituents containing more than one word to move. So in 17D, the adjective and noun move together past the numeral. And a final example at the top of page 4, this is the derivation for the type which is the most common in the world, the one that's the mirror image of English. First the noun moves past the adjective, and then the noun and adjective move past the numeral, and then the noun, adjective, numeral move past the demonstrative, gives the opposite order. Now, Cinque's approach, there are certain types that he claims do not exist. He offers an explanation for this. He claims that given the constraints on movement he's assuming, there's no possible way these could be derived in a language. But I won't go through the details. But what I will note is in fact, that four of the types that he assumes are impossible are, in fact, attested in my sample. The one that's most common is the one in 19, where you got the numeral first, and then the noun, and then the demonstrative and adjective following the noun. And it's attested in five languages that are grouped into three genera. The numbers that I'll be citing later in the paper will frequently be counting genera rather than languages. A genus is a genealogical group that's roughly comparable to the subfamilies of Indo-European. It's important, I've argued over the years, that it's important to count genera rather than languages because certain genealogical groups can, if that particular type is common, the language numbers may be misleading because of a small number of groups with many languages. So there are three genera here, two of them within the Austronesian family. And I'll give an example of, from Kilavila here, spoken in the Trobriand Islands in Papua New Guinea, numeral, noun, demonstrative, adjective. The other three types that Chinque's account predicts should not exist, but which are attested in my sample, are all three types I've talked about already. There's the one that's illustrated above by DeVehy in English. There's on the next page is the one where I have only the two examples from Wubulu and Sierra Papaluca. And there's the one where Haya is the only case. So the first problem with Chinque's account is that it predicts the non-existence of four types, which in fact actually exist. Okay, so what in 23 I've given a table that lists all 24 logical possible types. The second column is abbreviations I use throughout here, where the lowercase n stands for the noun, and the uppercase letters A, N, and D stand for the three modifiers of the noun, adjective, numeral, and demonstrative. Column marked options, there are numbers here, 14F, 14B, but that's an error. It should say 16, because I changed the handout without changing that part. So these refer to the particular marked options that are listed in 16. The number of marked options column counts up the number of marked options. The idea is the more marked options there are, Chinque is claiming the fewer languages there ought to be. So you'll see 0, 1s, 2s, and you'll see things like 2 plus. 2 plus means there are two marked options, but one of them is a very marked option. That's what the plus means. Similarly, 1 plus means that the one option marked option has is a very marked option. The next column gives the number of languages in terms of the Chinque 2005 game. This is an informal characterization. And then the last three columns now look at the data from my sample, number of languages, number of genera, and number of families. The order of the types in the chart here is in terms of the number of genera. The more genera it is, the higher it is on the list. If the number of genera is the same for two types, then I go to the number of families. And in one case where both the number of genera and the number of families are the same, then only then do I look at the number of languages. So Chinque's account is successful in predicting the two most frequent types, although you don't need a theory of movement to do that. He also correctly predicts the non-existence of the types that are not attested in my sample. And even though I've noted four types that his account predicts should not exist, these are among the least frequent in my sample. The biggest empirical problem with Chinque's account is in between, where the ones and the twos. So ideally, as you go down the number of marked options column, you should have a set of zeros, then a set of ones, then a set of one pluses, then a set of twos, then a set of two pluses, and then a set of asterisks. But in fact, if you look at the ones and twos, they're essentially in random order. One, one, two plus one, two plus two plus one, two, two plus one, one plus two plus. Not really any different from a random order. Or more specifically, the type on line 5 is, so the five types in the chart that are shown in boldface, italics, These are ones that are either more frequent or less frequent than Chipway's account predicts. So the type in line 5 is much more frequent than his account predicts, since it has two marked options, one of them very marked, and yet it is the fifth most common. There's an error in 24A at the very end of that line. It says line 4. It should say line 5. It's only in the last week, in fact, that the order of 4 to 5 switched as I've been collecting more data. In fact, this type that on line 5, if you look at the number of languages, it's the most common type other than the English type or its mirrored image. But again, I count genera. The point here, 18 of those 63 languages are all in the Oceanic branch of Austronesian. So that illustrates why it's misleading counting languages. You need to count something like genera instead. The types on line 7 and 8 have two marked options, one very marked, and yet they're more common than three types that have only one marked option, so they're more frequent than they ought to be. And the ones on lines 12 and 13, where there's only one marked option, yet they're less frequent than five types with two marked options. They're less common than his theory predicts. So by and large, except for the extremes, Schenker's account doesn't really do a very good job at predicting the relative order of the types other than those which are very rare and other than those which are very common. Okay, so let me turn now to the alternative approach that I want to offer here in terms of five surface principles. So the idea behind these principles is the more principles a particular word order adheres to, the more languages of the type you will find. So the first two principles are both called iconicity principles. They both involve the relative distance from the noun of the three types of modifiers. Iconicity principle 1 says that the adjective and the numeral tend to occur closer to the noun than the demonstrative when the demonstrative and the adjective or numeral or both occur on the same side of the noun. In other words, demonstrative tends to be as far from the noun as it can. Iconicity 2 says the adjective tends to occur closer to the noun than the numeral when they occur on the same side of the noun. In other words, the adjective tends to occur as close to the noun as it can, and numerals are in between. And we see that in English. So those three black horses, the demonstrative those is furthest from the noun, but the adjective black is closer to the noun, and the numerals in between. So as long as languages adhere to these, they satisfy those principles, but some of the types do not. The third principle I call the asymmetry principle. Exceptions to the iconicity principles will occur only with post-nominal modifiers. The iconicity principles apply more strongly to pre-modifiers than they do to post-nominal modifiers. So the idea behind this principle is to account for the fact that there seems to be much more freedom of order when the modifiers follow the noun than when they precede the noun. The fourth principle is what I call the post-nominal adjective preference. It's simply more common among the language of the world for adjectives to follow the nouns. About twice as common for noun adjective order compared to the adjective noun order that we have in English. And the fifth and last principle I call intra-categorial harmony. The demonstrative numeral adjective tend to occur on the same side of the noun. The choice of label here is essentially a pun on a principle that Hawkins 1983 proposed called intercategorial harmony, which was claiming that heads and modifiers in different types of categories tend to correlate. And I've argued that there is, in fact, no such correlation, but there is within a particular category. Now I call these five principles, by the way, descriptive principles. My idea of how to explain the relative frequency is, in a sense, involves two stages. Once this set of descriptive principles, and then you need to have deeper explanations for the descriptive principles. And I'll turn to that briefly at the end of the talk. The reason for distinguishing these is these descriptive principles, they can be tested empirically in a fairly rigorous fashion. The deeper explanations are necessarily more speculative and harder to actually demonstrate in a conclusive fashion. Okay, so the chart in 26 is similar to the one I gave earlier for Cinque, but this is in terms of my principles. So there are five columns labeled IP1, IP2, AP, NA, and IC. There's a key to this table on the next page if you need to see that. And those are the five principles. A Y means that that word order type conforms to the principle, and an asterisk means that that word order type violates that principle. And the column number of stars is the number of the principles that that particular type violates. And the last three columns are identical to the last three columns on the Cinque table we saw on the last page. So again, for the theory to work, ideally what you should see is 0, then a series of 1s, then a series of 2s, then a series of 3s, and then a series of 4s. And we don't quite get that here, but there are only two instances of types that deviate from that pattern. So as you go down, it starts with 0 and then a set of 1s, and then there's a 2, and then but it's followed by a 1. So the type on line 8, my theory predicts, ought to be less common than the type on line 9, but in fact it's slightly more common in my data. And the other one has a frequency which is different from what my theory predicts is the one on line 18, which violates only two principles, but it's less common than three types that violate three principles. But other than those two, we have a consistently monotonic, non-decreasing series of integers, zeros, ones, twos, threes, and then fours. So my principles predict the relative frequency much better than the principles assumed by Cinque. It turns out there's an easy way to partially explain away the two lines where my theory made the wrong prediction. And this comes from evidence that among the five principles, some of them are stronger than others. And this becomes clear if you look at the types that violate exactly one principle, the ones on lines 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 8. Sorry, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 9. So, of the ones that violate one principle, the most common is the one on line 2. That's the type in English. The only principle it violates is the adjective does not follow the noun, but it follows the iconicity principles, and all three are on the same side of the noun. So it's only the preference for putting adjectives after the noun that type violates. And the fact that it's so much more common than the others suggests that the post-nominal adjective preference is the weakest of the five principles. The next three types that violate exactly one principle, lines 3, 4, and 5, in all three cases, the principle that violates is intercategorial harmony. That's the principle that says they should all be on the same side of the noun. So the types on lines 3, 4, and 5, they all put the adjective after the noun. They all conform to the iconicity principles. The only thing they don't do is they don't put all modifiers on the same side of the noun. The last three types that violate exactly one principle on lines 6, 7, and 9, in these cases, they all violate, the one principle they violate is an iconicity principle. And the fact that they're less frequent suggests that the iconicity principles are the strongest principles, while the post-nominal adjective preference is the weakest, and intercategorial harmony is in between. With this in mind, now let's look at the type on line 8, which was less frequent than, it's less frequent than my theory predicts because it's more frequent than my theory predicts because it violates two principles, but it's more frequent than one type that violates only one principle. However, if you compare 8 and 9, the type on line 8 that violates two principles, the two principles it violates are the two principles I've argued are the weaker principles, namely the postnominal adjective preference and intercategorial harmony. Whereas the type on line 9, even though it violates only one principle, the one principle it violates is the iconicity principle. And we've already seen evidence that the iconicity principles are stronger. So in a way, it's a not surprising deviation that a type that violates two weaker principles might end up being more common than a type that violates only one but a stronger principle. A very similar story can be told about the type on line 18, which violates only two principles, although it's less common than three types that violate three principles. Crucially, that the two principles that the one on line 18 violates are both iconicity principles, whereas the three above it that are a little more common and violate three principles, they violate only one iconicity principle, and the others they violate are things like the postnominal adjective preference, which is a weaker principle. So what we can see is that once we look at the evidence for the relative strength of the principles, we can actually explain away the only two cases that deviate from what my theory predicts. Okay, so let me now turn to another kind of problem with Cinque's account. Cinque's account is formulated in terms of syntactic categories. He seemingly implicitly assumes that there's a one-to-one correspondence between semantic categories like demonstrative, numeral, and adjective, and syntactic categories of demonstrative, numeral, and adjective. Well, first of all, I just want to illustrate the extent cross-linguistically in which there is not a one-to-one correspondence, how a given semantic type can be realized syntactically in a variety of different ways in different languages. So, and in doing that, I'm going to be showing that the generalizations can not be described or explained in terms of syntactic categories, only in terms of semantic categories. So first, looking at what I call semantic adjectives, which is a way of avoiding confusion between adjectives of word class and a semantic category. Basically, semantic adjectives, roughly speaking, correspond to adjectives in English. Some people will call those property terms. They're stated predicates. They take a single argument. So how are these realized? In some languages, adjectives form a distinct word class, as they do in English. 30b, in some languages, semantic adjectives are actually verbs grammatically, and when modifying nouns, are really relative clauses. So an example illustrating that is example 31 from Ojibwe, where a tall man and a man who is singing, tall and sing are treated exactly the same way. They're verbs that have a relativizing prefix and a third person singular suffix d. So it's the same construction. 30c, in some languages, semantic adjectives are verbs grammatically, but can still modify nouns directly without occurring in relative clauses. I don't have an example on the handout illustrating that, but it's a not uncommon phenomenon. And the fourth possibility, D, in some languages, semantic adjectives are really verbs in internally headed relative clauses, so the noun or noun phrase is the subject, and the semantic adjective is the predicate, so that the semantic adjective is not modifying the noun at all. And the example 32 from Kootenay illustrates this. I saw the bad woman, where bad here is the verb of an internally headed relative clause. The noun pahki, woman, is the subject of that verb. The fact that the word for bad precedes woman is simply because Kootenay is a verb initial language. And just an example showing analogy at the top of the next page in the B example here. I said that the woman was bad. You can see the same sahan pashti here, and in this case it's a complement clause, where it's unambiguously the case that bad is the verb and woman is the subject of that verb. So we see that semantic adjectives are realized in different ways in different languages. There are even more ways that numerals are realized syntactically in different languages. In some languages, they form a distinct word class. In some languages, they belong to the class of adjectives. So, for example, the Swahili example in 34, you'll see the numeral in 1 and the adjective in A and the adjective long in B. In both cases, there's a noun class prefix on them, And it's different from the demonstrative in 34C, that even though the demonstrative 34C also is coded for noun class, for the demonstrative, the noun class marker is a suffix, illustrating the demonstratives are a different word class in Swahili. Irish is a clear example where adjectives are not numerals are not the same class of adjectives because they occur in different sides of the noun. In some languages, numerals modify classifiers, and these classifier phrases modify the noun. So in 36, a numeral classifier is possibly modifying the noun book. Although, in the literature, there are many people who propose that, at least for some languages, numeral classifiers, it's actually the classifier which is the head, and the noun which is dependent of it. So under that analysis of 36, it would be two classifiers of new book, a bit analogous to two bottles of wine in English. Now, if that's the structure, it's a very different structure, because the numeral is not modifying the noun at all. The noun is actually a dependent of the classifier. There are other languages without classifiers that exhibit head-like properties, implying that the noun is dependent on the noun. In other words, it's not just language with numeral classifiers where there's a possibility of the numeral being the head. So an example of this is given in Reef Berber in 37, where the construction with numerals 3 genitive hill is exactly the same as the genitive construction in 37b, house genitive man, and assuming house is the head in 37b, the word for 3 is, by analogy, presumably the house, the head in 37A. So it has a structure which is similar to the partitive construction in English, 3 of the hills, but this doesn't have partitive meaning in this language. It's simply the way you say 3 hills. And I actually found a second example of very similar to this while I was working in the meeting room this morning. A bony Cushitic language has a very similar kind of thing where you have a numeral plus noun, and the noun always occurs in the genitive case. So in that language, presumably as well, that's an argument for the numeral being the head. Now another possibility, there are languages where the numerals are actually verbs, and so when they're modifying a noun, they're actually in a relative clause for modifying a noun. So an example of this is in Creek, Muskogean language of the southeastern United States in 38, two men, the word for two here, has a resultant perfective inflection quite analogous to the resultant perfective inflection on the verb to stand in 38b. So that's evidence that that the numeral is a verb in a relative clause in 38a. And a final possibility is another type possibility if the numeral is a verb, but where the relative clause is internally head. So this is similar to what I said about Kootenai earlier. I saw two young men in 39. Two precedes young man, but it's only because it's the verb, and it's a verb initial language. Young man is the subject of that verb. So again, we see that there are a wide variety of different syntactic realizations of a single semantic notion. So so there's not the one-to-one correspondence that seems implicit in the approach in Cinque. In 40, I've given somewhat analogous examples of ways in which demonstratives are realized differently, but I'll skip that to move on. So my central claim here is stated in 44, is that the generalizations expressed by the five principles resulting in the different frequencies of the 24 types apply regardless of the syntactic realization of the semantic categories of demonstrative numeral adjective, that these generalizations cannot be expressed as generalizations over the syntactic categories. Now, the first piece of evidence for this is that the data, in classifying language, whether it's Greenberg or Hawkins or Cinque or me, the way we've classified languages is simply on the basis of the semantic categories. So the frequencies are based on semantics ignoring the syntactic categories. The fact that the unattested and rare types are rare and attested regardless of the syntactic realization is evidence that the syntactic realization doesn't matter. It doesn't matter whether the semantic adjective is a adjective or a verb or whatever. You don't get the rare types with it, say, preceding. You very rarely get demonstrative adjective in the numeral noun order, for example. Now, Cinque suggested in a footnote in his paper that in some languages that seem to be exceptions to his theory of what types are possible, in which adjectives appear outside numerals or even outside demonstratives, the adjectives are really verbs and hence are really relative clauses. He observes that relative clauses cross-linguistically tend to occur outside numerals and either inside or outside demonstratives, so that, quote, adjectives, unquote, which are really relative clauses, should occur outside numerals. So he does recognize at this point that the syntactic realization may, in fact, matter in some cases. But the problem with that is that his approach would seem to predict that we should find languages in which the semantic adjectives are verbs and in which the semantic adjective precedes the demonstrative or numeral before the noun. In the either demonstrative adjective numeral noun order, which we have a couple of examples of, and adjective demonstrative numeral noun order, which is unattested in my sample. Crucially, the three languages of the demonstrative adjective numeral noun type, in none of these three languages, are the semantic adjective verbs. So in Die Wehe, 49, this book is good, the adjective occurs here in predicate position without any verbal inflection. Like other Indic languages, if it were really a verb, there would be inflection there. And the English example is quite clear that good here is not a verb. It occurs accompanied by a copular verb, be. So it's not the case that languages where the adjective is too early in the noun phrase are languages in which adjectives are verbs. Furthermore, it turns out if you look at a lot of languages closely, when semantic adjectives are verbs, you find that even though they're verbs, they still tend to occur next to the noun, inside numerals, and in many cases in contrast to other relative clauses based on dynamic verbs. So the first example here comes from Amis, which is an Austronesian language of Taiwan, where relative clauses based on verbs expressing semantic adjectives must occur inside numerals, closer to the noun, while other relative clauses can occur on either side of the numeral. So, in 51A, we're looking at the relative order of two and black. All the modifiers precede the noun in Amis, so they're all preceding the noun pig, and the numeral two is further away from the adjective. If you try to put the adjective before the numeral, as in 51B, the result is ungrammatical. However, if the relative clause is one involving a dynamic verb, then the relative clause can occur before or after the numeral. So in 51C, caught by Mayo is closer to the noun than the numeral for three, whereas in 51D, it's further away from the noun than the numeral. So we're seeing that the relative clauses that involve semantic adjectives tend to have a stronger tendency to occur closer to the noun than other types of relative clauses, even though the syntactic category, relative clause, is the same. A similar kind of example is given in 52 from Nias, another Austronesian language spoken on the island of Nias in the Indian Ocean off the west coast of Sumatra. So if you look at 52A, so what's interesting in this language is the numerals themselves are also clearly in relative clauses because they're marked with a relativizer. So in 52A, I killed the two white dogs. Both white and two are preceded by the relativizer clitic, S or C. But it turns out that even though they're all relative clauses, the different relative clauses exhibit differences in terms of their proximity to the noun. So if you've got a relative clause involving a semantic adjective, like white in 52A, it has to occur next to the noun. In this case, all the modifiers are going after the noun. And the numeral's further away. If you try to reverse the order, as in 52B, the result is ungrammatical. You can't say dog, two, white. You have to say dog, white, two. Contrast this with a dynamic verb, the verb to sleep. Sleeping is not the most dynamic thing, but most languages that distinguish semantic adjectives from verbs will treat sleep as a verb. And we find exactly the opposite. We find that with the relative clause with the verb sleep, it has to occur outside the numeral. As in 52c, if you try to put it next to the noun, between the noun and the numeral, the result is ungrammatical. So all of these things are relative clauses. You know, white, to, and sleep are all relative clauses. So they have the same syntactic realization, but they differ in terms of proximity, their ordering with respect to each other after the noun. The example in 53 from Creek is really very similar to Nias. Those three black dogs going around chasing cats, the verb black, the relative clause based on black, has to occur right after the noun before the numeral for three, which is also a relative clause, whereas the going around chasing cats relative clause has to go after the numeral. So again, we see facts that are almost identical to the Nias facts. In Tukong Basi, another Austronesian language, the example in 54 and A and B are simply to demonstrate that, in fact, the word red is a verb. It has the same third person realis prefix that occurs on the verb to go up in 54B. But these semantic adjectives have a different position in the noun phrase than relative clauses based on dynamic verbs. They tend to be closer to the noun. So, crucially, there's a set of possessive clitics, meaning things like mine, his. These clitics have to go after a semantic adjective like young in C there, so it's child young, and then the possessive clitic, whereas relative clauses based on dynamic verbs occur outside the possessive clitic, further from the noun. And the last case, my favorite case of this, is from Chickasaw, same family as Creek, the Muskogean language, except that the relative clauses in Creek are internally headed. And so in 55, those three black dogs chased me. Dog be black, that's an internally headed relative clause. Dog is the subject, be black is the verb of that clause. Together that means black dog, and that's the subject of the verb to be three. In a higher internal heterologous clause, and then there's a demonstrative following it. Again, the only order of these words in Chickasaw is to have the verb be black closest to the noun, and then the numeral, and then the demonstrative further out. Even though it's a completely different construction from what we have in language like English, because these are internally heterologous clauses, the words for black and three here are not modifying nouns, they're verbs that take subjects, yet the same iconicity principle is observed. Now, it would be overstating the case to say that the syntactic realization makes no difference at all, because there are cases of exceptions where plausibly the syntactic structure may in fact play a role. So the example from Yapese in 56, Austronesian language, this violates the iconicity principle that says the adjective should be closer to the noun than the demonstrative, because in this language the demonstrative occurs closer to the noun, car, this, and then red. But in this case, the semantic adjective is in fact clearly in a relative clause because it has to be accompanied by a copula verb. So possibly the reason we're getting the adjective outside here is related to the fact that it is in a relative clause. A different kind of a case is presented by Teop in 57, another Austronesian language, where the adjective big is further from the noun than the demonstrative this. However, the syntactic structure here is really rather different from other languages because you have to have an article preceding the semantic adjective. So the structure is kind of like this car of mine, and then in apposition, a red one. So you have essentially have a separate noun phrase in apposition, So the fact that it's further from the noun than demonstrative is undoubtedly related to the fact that it's a different syntactic construction. On the other hand, these cases have to be fairly infrequent, otherwise we'd be finding lots of exceptions to the iconicity principles. And there are languages like Kiowila, where the adjective occurs further out than the demonstrative, but in fact, Kiowila is not a language in which semantic adjectives are verbs. So the example here simply illustrates that the word fast is not occurring with verbal morphology in contrast to the verb run off. So the fact when it's modifying a noun, it's not in a relative clause, it's not a verb. Slavey is another kind of one where the edge is further out from the numeral. This is a case where both the numeral and the adjective are relative clauses, so it's not like what I showed for Amis and Nias and Crete. In this case, you actually have the relative clause involving the adjective further away from the noun. So perhaps that if a semantic adjective is in a relative clause, it is slightly more likely to occur further from the noun. But it's also the case that adjectives that occur outside of numerals don't have to be verbs. So in 60, from Girawa, a Papuan language, a dog to black. The black there is further out, but it's not a verb. Now 61 and 62 give quantitative data on this. So the numbers here represent numbers of genera. So in 61, the rows distinguish languages in which the semantic adjectives are verbs as opposed to those where they are not verbs. I use three criteria, whether they occur with verb morphology, whether they occur with nominal morphology, and whether they occur with a copula. Occurring with nominal morphology or copula is evidence that they are not verbs. Occurring with verbal morphology is evidence that they are verbs. And what you see here is the first column is adjective is closer to the noun than the numeral, the second column, the numeral is closer to the noun than the adjective. We see that regardless of whether the adjective is a verb or not, it's overwhelmingly closer to the noun, 88% when it's a verb, 90% when it is not a verb. 62 is analogous data for looking at whether the adjective is outside the demonstrative or inside the demonstrative. And you can see that whether the adjective is a verb in the language or not, it's still 91% in both cases that the adjective is closer to the noun than the demonstrative. So we see quite clear evidence looking at an entire sample of languages that these possible cases that I've talked about that may be exceptions have to be exceptional. But by and large, it's simply the semantics which is determining the position of semantic adjectives relative to the verb, regardless of whether they are verbs or not. Now, we can do something, a kind of similar thing with numerals. If it's the case that in some languages with numeral classifiers, the numeral is not modifying the noun is actually a dependent of the classifier, you might expect the numeral to deviate from its position between the adjective and the demonstrative, but that's not the case. So in the Dagoth Edan in 62, it's a language with numeral classifiers, but the adjective occurs closer to the noun and the demonstrative is further out. So it's noun, adjective, numeral, demonstrative. It doesn't matter the fact the language is classifiers, you still have that. And 64, I've listed other languages that I've looked at which are identical in this respect. These are languages that have numeral classifiers, but that the order is noun, adjective, numeral, demonstrative. And similarly, the mirror image situation, 65, languages with the English word order, but where the numeral occurs with a classifier. 66, cases where the demonstrative numeral precedes the noun, but where the numeral is closer to the noun, even though there are classifiers. And it's not the case that languages where numerals are further from the noun are likely to have numeral classifiers. So Mavea in 67, the numeral is further from the noun than the demonstrative, but it's not one that takes a classifier. So again, in 70 and 71, I've given quantitative data bearing on this. So again, looking at whether the numeral is closer to the noun than the demonstrative, and looking, distinguishing languages with numeral classifiers than languages that lack numeral classifiers, and you see that, well, there is a small difference here. In languages with numeral classifiers, there's a 92% chance that the numeral and classifier will occur on the same side, closer to the noun than the demonstrative. In languages where the language lacks numeral classifiers, it's 84%. If we expect a difference at all, because since the numeral classifier is potentially a difference in type of construction, you might expect those to be more often further from the noun than demonstrative, but if anything, we find the opposite. 71 provides similar data looking at the relative order of adjective and numeral, whether the language has a classifier or not, and we see in both cases very similar percentages and overwhelming tendency for the adjective to occur closer to a noun. So it doesn't appear to make a difference whether the language has numeral classifiers or not. Okay, so what I've done so far is provided evidence that the iconicity principles are based on semantics, not the syntactic category. Now let me look briefly at the same question as it applies to the post-nominal adjective preference. Does the preference tendency for adjectives follow the noun true regardless of whether the semantic adjective is a verb or not? It turns out it doesn't matter. So in 72, we see that in languages in which the adjective is a verb, 69% of the time, the adjective follows the noun. If the adjective is not a verb, 65%. It's slightly higher when the adjective is a verb, but only slightly higher. So by and large, the preference applies regardless of the syntactic realization of the semantic adjective. We can also ask whether intercategorial harmony is semantic. So you might say, well, in language with numeral classifiers, since it's not even modifying the noun, why should the numeral classifier occur on the same side of the noun as the demonstrative and adjective? What the data in 73 and 74 show, however, is even in language with numeral classifiers, the numeral tends to occur on the same side as the demonstrative. So in 73, among language with numeral classifiers, the numeral and classifier on the same side of the noun as the demonstrative 65% of the time. If the language lacks classifiers, it is somewhat higher, 72%. So possibly the syntactic realization makes something of a difference, but it's still the case that the difference is relatively small, so it seems to be a predominantly semantic factors rather than the syntactic structure in question. 74 looks at very similar data in terms of the relative order of the numeral adjective relative to the noun, relative to each other, whether on the same side of the noun or not, distinguishing again language with classifiers and language without classifiers. And again, we see very little difference. Slightly more common among languages that lack classifiers to be on the same side, but only slightly. So again, I think we can assume that intercategorial harmony is based on semantics. So what this demonstrates is that any attempt like Cinque's that tries to formulate the generalizations in terms of syntactic categories cannot fail, because the grammars of the different languages have different syntactic constructions, so you can't treat them the same way syntactically. Rather, the principles are surface principles that apply based on the semantics. So let me finish up by making some brief remarks about deeper explanations for the principles. The two iconicity principles, I think it's related to what is more widely discussed in the literature of the orders among multiple adjectives. So the fact that in English you can say a beautiful black horse rather than a black beautiful horse. And there are lots of theories out there about what's going on there. My favorite is one in terms of the extent to which the meaning of the adjective is an inherent property of the referent of the noun phrase. The noun itself is highly inherent. So if something's a horse, the fact that it's a horse is fairly inherent. It's a black horse. It's easier to change a black horse to a different color than it is to change it to a different animal, but it's still easier to make a horse less beautiful. So being beautiful is less of an inherent feature of a horse than its color. And if we extend this to demonstrative numerals, so if we have three black horses, the fact that there are three of them is hardly an inherent property at all of those horses. It's a very temporary property. They're grouped together right now in a group of three, but come back an hour later and they may be in a different configuration. And demonstratives are not even remotely a property of the horses. If I say those horses, it's basically the relative position of me relative to the horses. So I think that we can extend the proposals that are made specifically for adjectives to apply to demonstratives and numerals as well to account for the iconicity principles. And the fact that if it's the inherentness that's relevant here, that explains a lot of the facts I talked about earlier. So why is it the case in a number of languages that the semantic adjectives, which are relative clauses, occur closer to the noun than those that represent relative clauses involving dynamic verbs? Because state of predicates represent much more inherent properties. If you have the black horse, which is running away, the which is running away is a very temporary property, and hence the differences there. Given the explanation of the iconicity principles, we would expect to find the facts that we found in terms of the iconicity principles being based on semantics. I have no good explanation for the asymmetry principle. I have to be quite honest about that. It's unclear to me why it is that you get much more deviations from iconicity when modifiers follow nouns rather than precede the noun. Now, note that Cinque claims he has an explanation. So, again, this is a typical example of a general explanation. The explanation for him is, well, the underlying order in all languages is demonstrative, adjective, numeral, noun, and given the constraints on movement, you can't rearrange those at all and have all three modifiers preceding the noun. So, insofar as his theory, internal Lewis theory, that will work, but I don't really think that's what's going on, so I don't know what's going on. Explaining intracategorial harmony. It was once thought that this was part of the overall Greenbergian correlations. It was once thought that modifiers tend to precede nouns in OB languages and modifiers tend to follow nouns in DO languages. But as I demonstrated in my 92 paper, this is not true for adjectives, and it's not true for numerals, and it's not true for demonstratives. For numerals, there's a close trend. There's a real trend, but it's the opposite from what the traditional one was. There's a trend for numerals to precede the noun in VO languages and to follow the noun in OV languages. What's going on here still is a principle of semantic commonality. They're all different modifiers of the noun. Even though they're different kinds of modifiers, they're all modifiers of the noun. So by treating them together, you're basing that on the fact that they all share that syntactic property, that they are modifiers of the noun. And finally, explaining the postnominal adjectival preference. Why is it that languages more often put adjectives after the noun? There have been proposals in the earlier literature that I don't think really work. So Greenberg, 1963, suggested that the noun adjective structure was similar to the subject verb structure, and he claimed that subject verb is more common because it's topic comment, and topic comment is more natural and common from topic. And he says the same thing for noun adjective, that the noun is the topic and the adjective is the comment, but it's unclear to me in what interesting sense we have a topic-comment relationship there. Hawkins, 1983, tried to explain this by saying that adjectives are heavier than numerals or demonstratives, and therefore they're more often postposed. But it's not clear that adjectives are that much longer. I mean, high-frequency adjectives tend to be monosyllabic, and larger numerals tend to be much longer than infrequent adjectives. So I don't think it's that. My hypothesis is the following. There are strong semantic commonalities between semantic adjectives and relative clauses, regardless of whether they're verbs or not in a language. So even in English, where adjectives are not verbs, for most noun phrases with an adjective modifying a noun, there's a paraphrase with a relative clause. The tall man, the man who is tall. Relative clauses and adjectives are much more in common semantically with each other than they have, say, with numerals and demonstratives. The data in 76 illustrates that the adjective tends to occur on the same side as the relative clause. Now, this table is restricting to languages where the adjectives are not verbs. Obviously, in languages where the adjectives are verbs, you expect adjectives and relative clauses to occur on the same side of the noun. But even in languages when they're not verbs, you see that when the relative clause precedes the noun, it's more common for the adjective to precede the noun by 31-17. If the relative clause follows the noun, it's more common for the adjective to follow the noun by 90-26. So we see that adjectives tend to be in the same side of the noun as relative clauses, regardless of whether they're verbs. The next part of the explanation is based on the fact that relative clauses themselves show an even stronger preference for post-noun position. Relative clauses follow the noun in something between 75% or 80% of the languages of the world. So for example, VO languages almost always put them after the noun. OV languages, the two orders of relative clause and noun are about equally common. So, and Hawkins has made proposals suggesting why relative clauses follow nouns more often for processing reasons. Whatever the reason for that, if relative clauses have a strong tendency to follow a noun, and if adjectives tend to behave like relative clauses, that would explain why we more often get adjectives following the noun than preceding the noun. So just to sum up, my principles predict the relative frequency of the different types better than Chicques, and the principles governing the order of demonstrative, numeral, adjective, noun are based on semantic categories, not syntactic.